John Wooden, The Indiana Years, brought to you by Marsh Supermarkets, Indiana's homegrown grocers since 1931.
Before all of this, before he became regarded as the greatest coach of all time in any sport and was honored by presidents and a who's who of sports luminaries, there was this, a small-town Indiana boy, a boy who grew up schooled in poetry as much as athletics, who courted his first and only girlfriend at the candy shop and later married her, who learned his trade throughout the state, from Martinsville to Indianapolis, West Lafayette, South Bend, and finally Terre Haute, where he helped break down a color barrier before going west to make history. This is the Hoosier story of a national treasure.
You know, you're talking about an icon nationally, worldwide in basketball, and got his start in Indiana. And all of Indiana knows that. All of Indiana appreciates what John Wooden did, not just as a basketball player, not just as a basketball coach, but who John Wooden is as a person.
Guys like Coach Wooden is the one that gave people here in Indiana really our tradition, because it started back the days where he started, and everybody in the Hoosier State likes their basketball, and it happened because of people like Johnny Wooden.
He meant everything. He meant everything to Indiana basketball, because he was born Hoosier out of Martinsville. Played at an Indiana University, Purdue, right here in the state. Coached high school basketball in the state of Indiana. Coached college basketball here in the state of Indiana. Johnny Wooden is basketball.
John Robert Wooden was born on October 14th, 1910, to Joshua Hugh and Roxy Wooden, weighing in at a prodigious 13 pounds. Most accounts have his birth in a tiny crossroads called Hall, about 30 miles southwest of Indianapolis. But there's mounting evidence that he was actually born in Martinsville, about 15 miles away. In typically tongue-in-cheek fashion, the man himself always said he was too young to remember. The second of four boys, John grew up mostly in Centerton, a farming community north of Martinsville. Their house there still stands, a few hundred yards down the road from Centerton Elementary School, which has been moved across the street in the 90 years since the Wooden boys attended.
You know, I think we had maybe a dozen houses and a church and a grade school and two country stores and a grain elevator and a post office and about a dozen houses. That's all there was to it.
John and his brothers worked on the family farm by day and listened to their father, a deeply religious man, read Walt Whitman and Shakespeare and the Bible at night. There were times of great sorrow. John's two sisters died in the same year, 1913, one at age three, the other in childbirth. And it was in many ways a spare, difficult life, with no electricity or running water, and little money. But there was fun, too. Wooden's father built a baseball diamond on the farm, drawing boys from all over. That included a neighbor 2 years older than Johnny named Branch McCracken, who would make his mark down the road at Indiana University. And, of course, there was basketball, a sport in its infancy, but fast becoming a Hoosier pastime.
There's a lot of truth that when a baby boy was born, they usually had a basketball about the first toy that they'd have. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's true anymore, but I think it was back in those days. We raised tomatoes. Mm-hmm. Yes, there's tomato baskets, not the peach basket, as the inventor of the game did. And Dad and Tech went up and barn about this regular height, and we had no basketballs and all, but Mother took old cotton socks and made them with rags. She was a good seamstress. I think she made all her clothes and her own, hardly ever had a store-bought dress, and made a lot of things, and made them near the size of basketball, and just with rags and some sort. Did a good job.
Wooden started playing competitively at Centerton Grade School, on a dirt court and under the tough love guidance of coach and principal Earl Warner, a World War I veteran and competitive boxer. Wooden was often disciplined, but would later call Warner one of the most influential men in his life. As Wooden was leading UCLA to the Final Four year after year, He would always reserve a place in the stands for his first coach. Warriner's daughter, Fran Abbott of Plainfield, recalls her father sending Wooden a blank check, asking to buy him 6 tickets for a regular season game. The tickets came in the mail, along with the check. Friendship, Wooden had written on it, is far too valuable to be measured in dollars.
It just seemed like it just made Daddy's life. When John would, when he would go out and see the games, and John would always have him around. He would have him in his hotel room and try to do things with Daddy when he could, you know. And Daddy would come back. He would be so excited. He was a totally different man after he'd seen John, you know. It was just, he made the latter years of my dad's life perfect. John didn't wait around until Daddy passed away. John was good to Daddy before he passed away. He wrote so many nice things about my dad in books. And you know, that wasn't necessary. He didn't have to do that. He did that though. So I love the man. I love my daddy and I love John.
Back in Centerton in the early 1920s, Johnny Wooden's journey was just getting started. After Centerton, Wooden attended Martinsville High School, taking the Interurban Electric Railway the 8 miles south down what is now Blue Bluff Road. Soon, however, the Woodens were forced to move to the city when they lost the farm after their hogs died from a faulty cholera inoculation. Wooden's father took a job at the Home Lawn Sanitarium, and the family moved into a modest frame house on Washington Street. That also still stands just west of the city square. Wooden excelled in school. Nothing less was accepted by his parents. And on the hardwood. An extremely fast and deceptively strong player, 5'10" and quickly filling out to a rock-hard 180 pounds, Wooden was known for his deft dribbling and for hurling his body all over the floor. But also, as at Centerton, for having a headstrong attitude to match. Nicknamed Pert for impertinent by coach Glenn Curtis, in his early varsity years, Wooden at times ran afoul of team rules and was relegated to the bench. Lessons he would learn from and teach later. But mostly Wooden was the star, with a huge stage to play on. Basketball was king in Martinsville, population 4,800, and shortly before Wooden's freshman year, a 5,200-seat gym was opened. It was the biggest basketball gym in Indiana at the time, high school or college, and one of the biggest in the country. Birchbeye Sr., the father of the former Indiana senator by the same name, officiated one of the first games, and national cartoonist Robert Ripley marked the opening by noting that, believe it or not, Martinsville, Indiana had a high school gym with a capacity that exceeded the population of the town. As for Wooden himself, he quickly grew into a high school legend. Herb Schwohmeyer, the author of Hoosier Hysteria and a close friend of Wooden's, remembers as a young boy reading about Wooden in the Sunday Indianapolis Star.
And one page was sports. And I cut out in my own scrapbook when I was 4 years old. Everybody in the state knew.
Bobby Plump's Tavern in Broad Ripple stands as a proud haven for high school basketball's yesteryear. One of his prized possessions is an original handwritten bracket from Wooden's final state tournament, and he too has great affection and respect for the man. The former Milan star knows as well as anyone the importance of small-town basketball to the growth of the game.
Where else would you ever hear of Centerton if it wouldn't be for John Wooden playing basketball there? Where would Centerton or Martinsville be without the basketball team? Where would Milan be without the basketball team? It identified you the only way that was possible back in those days to be identified, because if you won a sectional or knocked off the winner in a sectional, and especially if you won a regional, this whole state knew about it. And that's why I say it was the small communities that identified basketball in Indiana and made basketball synonymous with the state of Indiana.
Wooden was named All-State 3 straight years and led the Artesians to the state championship game in all of them. They lost to Marion in 1926, beat Muncie in 1927, and lost to Muncie in 1928. That last game, the first state championship game at the new Butler Fieldhouse, ended in stunning fashion, and would stick with Wooden as one of his biggest disappointments.
Well, I remember two things I remember at the game. We were leading 12 to 11, and they call a timeout, and they didn't have a timeout, so we had a technical foul shoot. I shot the technical foul, and I missed it. And I was supposed to be in the record of being a tremendous free throw shooter, but I missed that one. And then the ball goes back to the center jump, and Sechrist, their big center, jumped, tipped the ball to himself, which you couldn't do later in the rules, turned around in one swoop, a two-hand underhanded, and I don't remember that ever seeing a ball any higher. That was thrown in the game right down to the middle of this. And I've had many people that tell me that they saw the game and the ball, the gun went off while it was in the air. Well, as a matter of fact, we called a timeout. We got a very easy shot that our player would normally make, 99,100. But this time he put a little too spin on it and it came out. And we all, another player almost got the rebound to put it back in. If it hadn't spun an extra time, he'd put the rebound back in. This would happen. And yet I've had people, I was there. I saw the gun was there, but I was there too.
The sour ending notwithstanding, those remain the glory days for Martinsville basketball. Only once since have the Artesians reached the state championship game. And yet Wooden's legacy has carried on inside the gym's brick walls. A half century later, a young Steve Alford got his start there, from first through fourth grade when his father Sam coached at the school.
I think the thing that I learned early on was the difference in right and privilege, and it's something that I constantly hammer to our players to this day is that, and I think I learned that because every day as a gym rat, as a youngster, I'd go to my dad's practices and I knew this was the building John Wooden was in. And so anytime you kind of walk in those steps, it was almost hallowed ground, and you knew that it was a privilege to be in this gym, not a right, so learn how to play the game the right way and do it that way all the time, and that was the influence of Coach Wooden.
But to be sure, high school wasn't only about basketball and books for John Wooden. While at Martinsville High School, John Wooden worked at the Elks Club washing dishes and at the Van Camp's canning plant packing tomatoes. He laid gravel and dug sewers, and he fell head over heels for a girl one class behind him, the most beautiful girl in the world, he called her, Nellie Riley. The Riley family lived around the corner from the Woodens, but with one big obstacle in between, the house of the basketball coach. During the season, Glenn Curtis would stroll around town doing bed checks of his boys every night. Wooden delighted in telling how he worked around this, by getting in bed and turning out the lights with his clothes still on, then popping up after his coach passed by, sneaking down to Nellie's and sneaking home after his coach's bedroom light went out. Theirs was a courtship worthy of a Rockwell painting. Evening spent at Wick's Candy Kitchen or the Grace Theater, the clean-cut basketball star and the pretty girl who played the cornet. According to Nell's classmate and good friend, Gene Johnston, everyone knew it was destined to be.
He and Nellie fell in love in high school and that was that.
John and Nell agreed they would be married after he was through with college, and he headed to Purdue to play basketball and, more important, to study in its esteemed civil engineering department. Ironically, he was forced to change majors after 1 year, after discovering that civil engineering required work in the summer, and he needed that time to earn money. He later said had he known that requirement going in, he more than likely would have attended Indiana University to be closer to Nellie. But Wooden stayed at Purdue and changed his major to English. And he helped the Boilermakers basketball team to one of the greatest periods in their history. Under coach Ward Piggy Lambert, another man Wooden credited as a monumental influence in his life, Wooden was named All-American in 1930, 1931, and 1932. When he was a senior, Purdue was voted national champion and Wooden the National Player of the Year. Along the way, he broke the Big Ten scoring record held by Branch McCracken, his former neighbor. But it was another honor that Wooden treasures most from his college days, the Big Ten Academic Medal, given to the conference athlete with the highest grade point average. Wooden had graduated in the top 20 of his class of about 1,000.
Getting the Big Ten Academic Medal when I graduated, I think I earned that. The other thing somebody earned for me, I'd like to feel I had a little part in it, but others are more responsible. Yeah.
Once Wooden graduated, he and Nell didn't wait long. They were married in Indianapolis on August 8, 1932, in a small ceremony at Tabernacle Presbyterian Church at the corner of 34th and Central. They ate dinner at the Bamboo Inn on the Circle, and then attended a concert at Circle Theater by the Mills Brothers, a popular jazz and pop vocal quartet. The brothers sang many encores that night, too many for the groom's liking, he often joked later, considering the circumstances. The wedding didn't go off without a hitch. 2 days earlier, in the height of the Depression, Wooden savings, $909 and a nickel, he would say, was wiped out when the Martinsville Trust Company failed. But a friend saved the day, loaning the new couple $200, enough to get them started. They remained married for more than 52 years, until Nell passed away on March 21, 1985. For years afterward, Wooden would write a poem to his beloved on the 21st of every month.
There was only one woman, and it was Nell. And there was just total love there. I mean, there was no one else except Nell. And like you, if you remember, any time at a ball game, he'd have this little, his paper wadded up, curled up, and turn around and look for Nell. Before the game started, it was Nell he was looking for. So Nell was his idol. It was his, I think, his first love and only love.
Shortly after the wedding, the Woodens moved out of state for the first time, to Kentucky, where John became an English teacher, the athletic director, and coach of the basketball, baseball, football, and track teams at Dayton High School across the Ohio River from Cincinnati. His basketball coaching career got off to an inauspicious start. Describing himself as too critical, impatient, just a terrible coach, Wooden led the Green Devils to a 6-11 record that first season, what would be his only losing record in 40 seasons of coaching. But Wooden learned quickly. The next season, the Green Devils went 15-3. And then the Hoosier State called Wooden home. From 1934 to 1943, Wooden taught English and coached basketball at South Bend Central High School. It was a busy life. John and Nell had had two children, Nancy and James Hugh, and Wooden also spent time as the school's athletic director, comptroller, and baseball coach. But it was basketball, of course, where his legacy is best remembered. Wooden took what he had learned in Kentucky and put it to use. Not that he was always patient. To hear his best player, Eddie Ehlers, tell it, people who remember Wooden only as a quiet, elderly man at UCLA might not have recognized the fiery young man on the sideline and in the locker room of the South Bend Central Bears.
Yeah, don't let that program fool you. He's talking through that all the time. And he's got a loudmouth manager or somebody sitting right next to him chewing on the official. But he's like this, so they can't distinguish, meaning they, the officials, who's giving them a hard time. They think it's this manager, but it's Coach Wooden. Yeah, we're playing Lafayette, Jeff of Lafayette, in the state championship in the semifinals. And I thought we were doing okay in the first half, but when we went in, Coach Wooden was berserk, and they had locked the door to our locker room, and we couldn't get in. We were out in the hall, and you can imagine how frustrated he became, and he started kicking the door down. And when we got in there, they really chewed this out, and me particularly. And it went to the depths of my soul as to what I was doing wrong. I'm as egotistical as the next guy. I thought I was playing okay, but proved to be otherwise. And he got to me. And when we came out in the second half, he'd gotten to all of us. And we won going away.
That was another thing Ehlers and his teammates remembered well. Wooden knew how to win.
Why did it take you so long out in California to find out how great he is? Hell, we knew he was as great as he is when he was here.
Employing a fast-breaking and heavy-pressing style, regarded as radical at the time, that Wooden had learned from Piggy Lambert at Purdue, and which he would later perfect at UCLA. South Bend Central had a record of 197 wins and just 28 losses in those 9 seasons. Several times they reached the regional round of the state tournament and twice they won it. For all that success, however, Wooden was never able to lead the team to a state championship. It was a rare failing that was still sticking in his craw 3 decades later, when he first met the most decorated high school coach in state history, six-time champ Bill Green.
Well, I met Coach Wooden in 1975 in Martinsville, Indiana, where John grew up and played basketball. And they had a John Wooden Day and a parade. And I was fortunate enough to get in the same car with Coach Wooden. And I had won a championship in 75 in high school. And we just got to talking, and he was so impressed with being the Indiana State basketball champ.
Well, I'm told Coach Green from Marion, he was now in Florida, I would correspond once in a while, I'll trade him two or three NCAA champions for one high school championship, Indiana high school championship as a coach.
I still won't trade one championship for three national championships.
Little known to many, during this time, Wooden also played basketball professionally. Starting when he was in Kentucky and continuing into his time at South Bend, Wooden spent 7 seasons in various leagues that were forerunners to today's NBA, starting in 1932 with the National Basketball League. Most of that time, Wooden played for the Indianapolis Kotskis, owned by local grocer Frank Kotski. Wooden would drive for hours to play in 30 or 40 games a season, many in Butler Fieldhouse or the Tyndall Armory in downtown Indianapolis. For a time, he played alongside his old neighbor, Branch McCracken, as well as older brother Maurice Cat Wooden. Interestingly, Wooden and McCracken's paths will cross yet again later, in 1960, when along with Wooden's Purdue teammate Charles Stretch Murphy and coach Piggy Lambert, they became the first Hoosiers to be inducted into the Naismith Memorial Basketball Hall of Fame. But with the Kotskis, it was John Wooden who was the main draw. He led the league in scoring one season and finished near the top in several others, and once reportedly hit 134 free throws in a row.
The ball players got $25 a game, except Wooden. He got 50, and big time.
As with so many other young men of that era, however, December 7th, 1941 changed everything. That's when the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, prompting the United States to enter World War II and hundreds of thousands of Americans to enlist in the cause. Wooden was among them. He was called to active duty in 1943 as a Navy lieutenant and sent first to North Carolina and then to Iowa for pre-flight training. Then came a monumental twist of fate. In 1945, with the war raging, Wooden received orders to report for duty aboard the USS Franklin in the South Pacific. But just before he was to board, Wooden's appendix ruptured, and his orders were canceled. On March 19th of that year, the sailor who took his place, Freddie Stalkup, one of Wooden's fraternity brothers at Purdue, and more than 700 other soldiers died when the Franklin was bombed by a Japanese plane. Wooden went on to have several assignments, but he never served overseas. Wooden's service is honored, along with that of hundreds of other Hoosiers, with a brick in the Morgan County Veterans Memorial, next to the public library in Martinsville. Also there is an etching of the USS Franklin ablaze in battle. Friends said every time Wooden returned to Indiana, most recently on Thanksgiving of 2005, he made a point to visit that monument, and tears would come to his eyes. While he was in South Bend Central, John Wooden wrote a poem on the back of the school newspaper that ended with this verse. Before eternity takes me, my fondest hope is but to see and know that something I have done has made for some a brighter sun. In his final 2 years in Indiana, Wooden would make such a difference. Wooden returned to South Bend at war's end to find that the city had changed. Many of his fellow coaches who also went to war weren't given their old jobs back, and even though Wooden was, that didn't sit well with him, and he decided it was time to leave. He was courted by Marion and Kokomo high schools, but instead took a job at the Indiana State Teachers College, now known just as Indiana State, in Terre Haute. He would be there for just 2 years, but he had excellent teams and they were high times for a young local boy named Bobby Slick Leonard, who called the Sycamores his heroes and can still roll off the starting five.
I was a freshman in high school at Gershmeyer Tech, and Johnny had a great ball club there. But I used to slip in that 7th Street entrance to the old gym at Indiana State and sit in there up the top row and watch practice.
Yet the significance of those 2 years went far beyond the basketball court. After losing his first game as a college coach, Wooden led the Sycamores to a 17-8 record that first season, which brought an invitation to Kansas City to play in the national playoffs of the NAIB, forerunner to today's NAIA. But there was a catch. Clarence Walker, one of the Sycamores' substitutes, would not be able to join the team because of a rule prohibiting black players. Wooden quietly declined the offer and kept his team home. The next season, the Sycamores finished 27-7 and again were invited to the playoffs. The rule had changed. Black players could play, but it was understood that they couldn't otherwise appear publicly with the team. Wooden declined again, saying that that would be a greater humiliation to Walker than not being able to go at all. But then the NAACP urged Wooden to reconsider, arguing that Walker simply being allowed to compete would be a good start. A few black players had competed in other postseason tournaments, but not in this one, and not outside of New York. After getting the approval of Walker and his parents, Wooden took the Sycamores to Kansas City. Along the way, as teammates Lenny Rozeski and Jim Powers remember, they often ate at dingy roadside stores because restaurants wouldn't serve one of their players.
The team came in and sat down, and at that time, Clarence wasn't in there yet. Well, I don't know where he was, but he was standing outside. And the person saw him come in. They decided that they weren't going to feed him. So we decided that we're not going to eat. They had the food ready to eat. Well, I imagine there were some on the plates, and so we just all walked out. When we walked out with Clarence Walker.
There have been times when I think we got bologna sandwiches or something, and we just took them out to the car, and that was our lunch or dinner or whatever. And then Clarence had to stay at another person's home during the week that we were there at Kansas City. So Wooden was a trailblazer as far as that was concerned.
Walker, who died in 1989, wrote a highly personal journal while at Indiana State about the racism he faced and his feelings for Coach Wooden. He kept it to himself for years, not even showing it to his children until nearly 3 decades later, when his son Kevin was a senior at East Chicago, Washington, and was despondent about losing his final basketball game. The 9-page typed document Clarence Walker handed his son the next morning included a long passage about the Sycamores' trip to Kansas City. It was titled, Mr. J.C., Jim Crow.
We left about 9 on a Saturday morning. That evening, we arrived in Columbia, Missouri to spend the night. They expected a rose. I was not allowed to stay, but there was no hotels for Negroes, no private rooms which were available. I stayed there all night, being at the hotel. He stayed downstairs next to the lavatory, was a room with some broken furniture in it. A cot was rolled in there, and there was my quarters for the night. About 2 a.m., a group of boys came down to the bathroom. They were loud and boisterous, enough to awaken me. About 10 minutes later, they all cleared out, but believe me, they did not take everything with them. The aroma coming from the bathroom through the furnace inlet was unbearable. One can guess how much sleep I got.
Walker couldn't stay with the team in Kansas City either, and on the way home, it was more of the same at a hotel in Effingham, Illinois.
As we walked in the lobby, a lady had a little girl in her arms about 3 or 4 years old. When the girl saw me, she said, "Look, Mommy, a nigger." And the lady said, "Shh, a colored boy." I slept downstairs in the basement. Mr. Wooden and I had breakfast together. I felt very relieved when we started to tear hope.
Of Wooden, Clarence Walker wrote effusively. He praised him for his coaching ability and for how he steadfastly steered his players through the racial hatred they encountered. Most of all, Walker praised Wooden's courage.
If all people were in mind as he is in character, I think Mr. J.C. would be trivial. That's impactful. All of those little setbacks, if you will, brought them to the point of not only making a stand for the team, but for the nation.
Walker played only sparingly in Kansas City, but the color barrier had been broken. And Indiana State made it all the way to the finals before falling to Louisville. It was Wooden's final game as part of an Indiana team. Several major colleges came calling on the up-and-coming young coach, and after nearly accepting a job with Minnesota, Wooden chose UCLA. The rest is American sports history. 10 national championships, an overall record with the Bruins of 620 wins and just 147 losses in 27 years. Voted by a Sporting News panel of more than 100 coaches, past and present, as the greatest coach of any time in any sport. All from a farm boy from Indiana. The roots here remain deep. Indiana was the home of Wooden's four mentors, his father Hugh and his three early coaches, Earl Warner at Centerton, Glenn Curtis at Martinsville, and Piggy Lambert at Purdue. It was the home to the one true love of his life, the greatest thing that ever happened to me, Wooden wrote of his wife Nell, and where their children grew up. It is the resting place of his parents and two sisters, whose graves are in a small cemetery outside Centerton. And Wooden, of course, is remembered too. In Centerton, in Martinsville, in Indianapolis, in West Lafayette and South Bend and Terre Haute and throughout the Hoosier State, a state where he was fond of saying he left a piece of his heart. He is remembered.
You don't find people like that every day. They just don't make them like that. They only come along once in a lifetime.
Anywhere, you can go anywhere in Indiana and say, do you know John Wooden? And they'll say, yes, we do. He was the start, I think, of Indiana basketball.
I know growing up, all I wanted to do by watching his teams and watching other players is try to be the best I could. And I loved the game, and I wanted to get better. And being from a small town probably makes it a little more special because we didn't have games every night. We had to do it all on our own.
And I didn't play for Coach Wooden. I didn't play at UCLA. But he took the time to help me. He took the time, one, to give me advice as a young coach and to try to tell me some things I think were going to be beneficial. But he did that because we were Indiana natives, and we had that tie as being guys that grew up playing in Indiana high school basketball.
I mean, John Wooden became more of a mentor than a coach, than anything. And I'd say the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree. He's the tree, and you have all these apples.
And even 100 years from now, there'll still be a history about John Wooden and what legacy he has left, not just about himself, because it was never about himself, but what he has left to so many people and made such an impression on so many lives.
I used to love to sit in the back of his car. We didn't have school buses, because he drove to the games, and I got to watch him and Mrs. Wooden. That's why I have that, because he inspired me to get the right girl and stick with her, and you're going to have a happy life. So, does that make you a great basketball player? I don't know. But it sure helped me along the road of life.
Just, I think his roots are in Indiana. I don't think California has anything compared to his roots in Indiana. His daddy, my dad, Curtis, all these people, I think those are his roots. Indiana is his roots. Indiana is his home. Indiana will always be his home.
John Wooden, The Indiana Years, brought to you by Marsh Supermarkets, Indiana's homegrown grocers since 1931.